Welcome to the Travel Nurse YouTube channel. My name is A.A. Mumin and I want to welcome you to yet another episode. Today we are going to talk about two tests that are mandatory for you to take in your NMC UK registration. Okay, so before we proceed, I want to thank all of you for subscribing to the channel, for following the channel for updates. Please, if you haven't subscribed, kindly do so now and also click on the notification button so that anytime that there is an upload of a new video, you'll be notified and you'll be among the first people to watch the video. Okay, so as I said, we are still on the UK NMC registration or the application. And today we are going to talk about one of the tests that is mandatory for you to take, and that is the CBT, the competence-based test. So that is the test one. We are going to look at the structure, what it entails, areas that it covers, the various domains. We are going to look at where you can have this test. We are going to discuss about the pass rates for the various disciplines. We are also going to look at some study materials that will help you, pass the exam in one sitting. We are also going to look at probably some tips that will help you conquer the exam once and for all. So do not go anywhere, kindly stick to this channel. We'll take a short breather, we'll be right back. Welcome back. Okay, so as I said, in your quest to become a registered nurse in the United Kingdom, during the application process, there are two tests that you have to take. One being the competence-based test, the CBT. The second one being the objective structured clinical exam, which is the OSCE. So today we are going to talk about the CBT as I indicated earlier. Okay, so this test is computer-based. And it consists of 120 multiple choice questions, and it comes in four main domains. The domains being adult nursing, mental health nursing, learning disability, and children's nursing or pediatrics. So these are the four main domains that you could register to, the test on it. So if you are a registered general nurse, an RGN, then yours is the adult nursing. If you are a psychiatric nurse or a mental health nurse, then obviously you are going to sit for the mental health CBT. If you are a children's nurse, the same, the learning disability nurse, the same. Okay, so before you initially, you could just go to the PSNVU website and register for it. So this particular exam is organized by PSNVU in collaboration with the NMC UK, and this can be taken either in the UK or any part of the world, because PSNVU has a lot of offices or outlets or test centers spread across the world. So I think they have, for Ghana, they have only one center, which is in Accra. For Nigeria, they have about three or four, and in other places they have multiple test centers as well. So we are going to look at this structure, as I said, but before then, this is how its registration goes about. Initially you could just register, as I said, but now you will need to initiate the NMC application first. So at a stage that is immediately after the eligibility and qualification criteria has been met, NMC UK will now give you the go ahead or the approval to take the test. Okay, so when you start with your NMC UK application, you forward or upload your document and you pay the £140 application fee NMC UK will contact the NMC in your home country or the nursing regulatory body in your home country to, verify your details to ascertain whether you are indeed a qualified nurse practicing in your country. So if all these things go through, you are now given the green light. So a link will be notified by an email, and you follow the link to the PersonView website where an automatic username will be generated for you. You reset your password and the tests according to your qualification. As I said, either it is adult nursing, mental health, LND, or children's nursing, you register. This particular test comes as a fee of £83 or its equivalent in your local currency. So after you register, you pick a date. Okay, it is written multiple times within a month. Written multiple times within a month. So you can choose a flexible date that you think by then you would have prepared. Of course, with every exam, you have to prepare. Do not take it lightly. Okay, so when you pay the fee, you have to register. If you are to go to the center, you have to provide an identity, and usually they take an international traveling passport. That is what is required of you for the registration. So after the £83 is paid, you registered, now you book your dates and you start preparing for the exam. As I said, the exam is 120 MCQs. And the exam lasts for 4 hours or 240 minutes, which means each question approximately takes 2 minutes. You have to spend 2 minutes on each question. So you are just choosing answers. As I said, you are to choose the most suitable answer because the options given usually look alike. Okay, so you choose the most likely answer out of the options given. We'll look at some of the questions later. Sample questions. So 120 questions within 4 hours, and there are no designated breaks. Unless, of course, you want to take a break and your time will not be stopped. So you prompt the test administrator, then it will facilitate a quick one for you and you need to be escorted. So I would advise that before the exam, you need to get there on time and also prepare yourself. Probably take something light or a light food or a light diet before you go. Okay, the test can be taken either in the morning or in the afternoon. Okay, so you don't need any material at all. You don't need any material. Computers are provided for you. You go, you sit behind the computer, the questions, you enter your details, the questions come, you start answering. If you are not sure of an answer, you can skip and go to the next question, and after that you can come back, go through your questions or go through your answers, then make the necessary corrections. So these tests, you can sit for it on 2 occasions within a span of 10 days. So if you fail twice, initially I think it was thrice, if you fail twice, it means you have to start the whole NMC process again. Yes, because it is multiple choice questions and it is not that difficult, people tend to underestimate it and they don't get the required pass score, because each domain I mentioned, there's a pass designated pass score for adult nursing, for mental health, and all the other disciplines. So let's quickly look at the past scores and their interpretations. So this is the current overall pass mark that is needed by NMC UK. So as I explained earlier, we have four domains depending on your qualification, which domain you sit for the exam. So either you sit for the adult nursing, mental health nursing, learning and disability nursing, children's nursing, and midwifery. Okay, so these are the domains. So if you sit for the adult nursing or the registered general nursing, then you are expected to, have an overall pass mark of 68%. 68% of the 120 questions will give you, about 81. Yeah, if you get 81 correct answers, then you get the 71. With mental health nursing, you need 72% pass mark, which is about 85-86. Learning disability, 71. Children's nursing, 71. If you're coming as a midwife, then you need 63. So to be on the safer side, do not get less than 80 or probably 90 out of 120 questions. So you don't have to get more than 30 questions wrong. So you need constant practice. As I said, you have to read all the areas, from communication, from drug administration, from wound care or wound management, from leadership. You have to read all to understand before you sit for the exam, and with that you can easily get the required mark. So you need to know this before you sit in for the exam. Okay, so adult nursing 68%, mental health nursing 72%, learning and disability nursing 71%, children's nursing 71%, midwifery 63%. So these are the required overall pass mark. So that was the interpretation of the scores that is you are expected to get for you to pass the exam. So in all these domains that I mentioned, the four domains, these are the areas that your questions are being set from. So they look at the NMC code, they look at the professional practice, yes. So they look at communication, they look at administration of medicine or drug administration or calculation, they look at safeguarding of the patient's rights. Okay, they look at patient safety, they look at wound management. So all these areas, questions come from all these areas. That is what I'm trying to say. Okay, so we'll now look at some study materials that you could use in your quest to write this particular exam. So first on the list is the Royal Medicine's Manual. This is a comprehensive nursing textbook that when you study, that covers all the areas and disciplines of nursing, that when you judiciously read it, you get most of your answers there. We'll look at the CBT bank questions. Of course, you know about that, the 1060 questions, though most of them are being repeated. When you study this and try and answer all of them, indeed the exams becomes much easier for you. Now let's look at the some of the things that you can do to easily pass this exam. As I said, when you look at the CBT bank question, the past questions, most of the questions are repeated because all the questions are set around these areas that I mentioned earlier: the professional conduct, NMC code, communication, safeguarding, drug calculation, and the likes. So what I will entreat you to do is not to memorize the answers. A lot of people do that mistake, but rather try to understand the rationale behind the answer chosen, the correct answer. This is because when you go for the test, the question might be repeated but in a different format. Okay, you will twist it a little bit. So if you don't read to understand, you will tend to choose the wrong answer. That is one. Two, with the drug calculation, it is basically simple calculations. You don't need a calculator to do that. During the exam, you will be provided with a formical board or an erasable board that you will use for your rough work. So they give you simple calculations. For instance, they ask you patient A is on top metronidazole, let's say 800 milligram, okay, in the morning, and the available tablets you have is 200 milligram, okay? So how many tablets are you going to administer? You understand? So you just divide 2 by the 8 or 8 by the 2, then you just administer 4 tablets. Okay, this is just an example. Or you say he's on 800 milligram and you have 400 milligram available. How many tablets are you going to serve? So that you get A, 1, okay, B, 3, C, 2. Okay, so obviously the answer is 2, because 800 and your available tablet is 400, so you give 2. So that is it. You don't need to panic. You don't need any complicated calculation. You do any complicated calculations. It's just simple maths with the drug calculations. So basically, that is it. And also, do not try to cheat. You are on your own. When you are in the exam hall, sitting behind your computer, you need to be focused. There are CCTV cameras in operation everywhere. So with the little malpractice you try to do, because obviously you are not allowed to carry your phones, anything at all, you don't carry inside. Okay, and if you try any form of malpractice, it will lead to your exam or results being cancelled. And please, when you arrive at the test center 15 minutes late, okay, if your exam is at 8 a.m. and we arrive at the center 8:15, you will not be allowed to take the test. You will not be allowed to take the test. So you need to be there on time. Okay, so let's now look at some of the sample questions. But before that, just as we did for the IELTS, if you need the materials for the CBT, the past questions, the test tickets manual or reading list, kindly leave your email in the comment box and I will gladly share with you. So now let's go and look at some of the sample questions. So now we look at some of the sample questions. As I said, these questions are repeated. But before then, let me remind you that the questions and answers are based on the UK practice. They are based on the UK practice. Though we have the general practice or the globally accepted way of practice as a nurse, but some of these questions are tailored to the UK practice. So you have to read the NMC UK code, you have to read all the necessary materials given you before you sit for the exam. Do not make assumptions, do not use your past experience back home and way of doing things or practicing back home to answer the questions, else you get most of them wrong. So as I said, there are questions on NMC and Yaro. So if this question, for instance, is on NMC, it says, what is the role of the NMC, that's the Nurse and Midwifery Council? A, to represent or campaign on behalf of nurses and midwives. B, to regulate hospital and other healthcare settings in the UK. C, to regulate healthcare assistance. D, to regulate nurses and midwives in the UK to protect the public. So that is the right answer. Okay, this is another question. It says, all are purposes of NMC except. These are some of the things that you have to be careful, look out for. Except, not, do not. Okay. So these questions are saying all are purposes of NMC except. So A, NMC's role is to regulate nurses and midwives in England, Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland. B, it sets standards of education, training, conduct and performance so that nurses and midwives can deliver high quality healthcare throughout their careers. C, it makes sure that nurses and midwives keep their skills and knowledge
up to date and uphold its professional standards. D. It is responsible for regulating hospital and other healthcare settings. Okay, you know, these answers are similar, as I said. So you choose the most likely one. If you realize from A to C is talking about the purposes of NMC. D is talking about the role of NMC. So that is what makes the D distinct or extinct from the rest. Okay, so D is the answer. Let's move on. Okay, so this is talking about leadership or something like that. Yeah, it says a person supervising a nursing student in the clinical area is called as A, mentor, B, preceptor, C, interceptor, D, supervisor. Again, look at these answers. All of them can be the answer, but they're asking for the most likely, the most appropriate. So mentor, okay? Then training of student nurses is the responsibility of, it's talking about student nurses who are student nurses. This is training of nurses, but student, I mean nurses, so who come on placement or on the ward for clinicals. So it's A, ward in charge, B, senior nurses, C, team leaders, D, all RNs or all registered nurses. And that is the answer. Okay, this is about documentation. It reads, when do we need to document? A, as soon as possible after an event has happened, to provide current up-to-date information about the care and condition of the patient or client. B, every hour. C, when there are significant changes to the patient's condition. D, at the end of the shift. If you realize, at all these times, we do some form of documentation. Okay, almost every hour, when there are significant changes in the patient's condition, we document. At the end of the shift, of course, we do our notes. We do handover notes, we do care notes and all those stuff. But the most appropriate one is the A. As soon as possible, after an event has happened, irrespective of the time, okay, to provide current up-to-date information about the care and condition of the patient or client. So you need to be fast, smart in choosing your answers. The next one says all should be seen in a good documentation except all should be seen in a good documentation except A, legible handwriting, B, name and signature, position, date and time, C, abbreviations, jargons, meaningless phrases, irrelevant speculation and offensive subjective statements, D, a correct, consistent and factual data. So C is the most appropriate answer. Okay, this is talking about safeguarding. So when will you disclose the identity of a patient under your care? A, you can disclose it anytime you want. It doesn't work that way. You will be sealed. B, when a patient relative wishes to know. No, that is not in accordance to UK guidance. C, when media demands for it. No. D, justified by public interest, law and order. Okay, so when the condition of the patient is of public interest, for instance, with this COVID-19 is of public interest, because if the patient tests positive, the test results has to be known in order to protect the patient and others around him from, contracting the virus. Okay, so this also talks about, I'm just picking one or two questions from some of the areas that you study. Okay, so this is on wound care or wound management. It reads, a patient developed pressure ulcer. The wound is round, extends to the dermis. is shallow. There is visible reddish to pinkish tissue. What stage is the pressure ulcer? Stage 1, B, stage 2, C, stage 3, D, stage 4. Of course, dermis, not epidermis, so there's a dermis. So it's stage 2. Know if the various layers of the skin, okay? And this one reads, a client is admitted to the emergency department after a motorcycle accident that resulted in the client skidding across a cement parking lot. Since the client was wearing shorts, there are large areas on the legs where skin is ripped off. The wound is best described as A, abrasion, B, unapproximated laceration, just like that. So, abrasion, of course. Then, this is some questions on medication. So, the medication, it comes in all forms. Administration of medication, writing medication, drug calculation, fluid and intake and output, monitoring, all those things are captured. Okay, so this one says patient has next dose of digoxin but has cardiac rates of 58, which is low. Okay, so what do you do? You say A, omit dose, record why and inform the doctor. B, give dose and tell the doctor. C, give dose as prescribed. So you see that all these answers have something in common, so I have to choose the most appropriate one. The right thing to do is, of course, omit the dose you don't give, record why, document, and inform the doctor. This one says, which drug is to be avoided by a patient on digoxin? So look at the contraindications of the medication. A is corticosteroid, B, NSAIDs. So answer is NSAID. Those in digoxin do not take non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Then the other one is saying, which of the following should be considered before giving the chosen? A, allergies, B, drug interactions, C, other interactions with food or substances like alcohol and tobacco, D, medical problems, for instance, thyroid problems, kidney diseases, etc., and all the above. Again, all the above is the answer. Then, this also medication, it reads ibuprofen, okay, and ibuprofen 200. So ibuprofen, pronunciation doesn't matter, it depends on the school you attended. So an ibuprofen 200 milligram tablet has been prescribed. You only have a 400 milligram coated ibuprofen tablet. What should you do? A, give half of the tablet. In some practices elsewhere, you do that. B, crush the tablet and give half of the amount. C, order the different dose of tablet from pharmacy. D, omit. So the answer is you order the different dose. You don't hear by UK standard, UK practice. You don't crush drugs. You don't break them into two. Okay. Then a patient develops shortness of breath after administering third dose of penicillin. The patient is unwell. What's your response? Obviously, this patient is responding to allergy. Maybe he's allergic to penicillin. So A, call for help. Ensure anaphylaxis pack is available. You assess ABC. Don't leave the patient until medical help comes. Exactly. So we do the ABC. All these things, yeah, because the patient's running into an anaphylactic shock. Then again, medication. It says which is the most dangerous site for intramuscular injection? IM, ventrogluteal, deltoid, C, rectus femoris, D, dorsogluteal. So per the UK practice standard, dorsogluteal is the most dangerous. Okay. Then This one says, which is the best site for giving IM injection on the buttocks? It was a specific buttocks. A says upper outer quadrant, B upper inner quadrant, lower outer quadrant, lower inner quadrant. Answer is what? Upper outer quadrant. So you see the questions are, you see they are cheap, they are easier, but you need to think. You have to go through the possible answers very carefully. Yeah, that you can easily deviate, you can easily get them wrong. This one says, when administering injection in the buttocks. So look at this. I intentionally brought this question because it's the same talking about IM injection on the buttocks, but you know, they reframed the question. Okay, so that's why I say don't memorize the answers. Look at the question very well. Look at the question very well. When administering injection in the buttocks, it should be given A, right upper quadrant, B, left upper quadrant, C, right lower quadrant, D, left lower quadrant. So we all know in giving IM injection the buttocks, you target the upper outer quadrant. That is the preferred site. So either it is left or right, it doesn't matter. So here both answers A and B are correct. Then this one, as I said, medication covers all spheres. So this is input and output. It says as a registered nurse you are expected to calculate fluid volume balance of a patient whose input is 2,437 mils and output is 750 mils. So as I said, I'm not going to give you any tedious calculations. So this is just subtraction. Okay. Yes, we find out the difference. So they'll give you an erasable board or formicable board. So you just write on it, after which you claim. So the answer after you've done is 1,887, which is a positive balance. Then just another form of it, it says the doctor prescribes a dose of 9 milligrams of an anticoagulant for a patient being treated for thrombosis. The drug is being supplied in 3 milligram tablets. How many tablets should you administer? Simple math. Okay, the prescribed drug was what? 9. And the supplied drug came in 3 milligram. So how many tablets? You divide the 9 by 3. A is 3 tablets, B 1.5 tablets, C is 6 tablets. So obviously the answer is A. So these are some of the drug calculations you'll be meeting. So that's why I said you don't necessarily need a calculator. Then the doctor prescribed a dose of 9. Yeah, so you see that it's the same question that has been repeated. Yeah, so let's look at this. It says a patient is prescribed 120 of Hartmann's solution to be given over 5 hours. The micro drip delivers 60 drops per mil. Calculate the required drip rate in drops per minute. So this is drug calculation, IV infusion, intravenous, fluid. You are calculating the drop rate. So in calculating drop rate is the volume required over hours times the drop factor. So here the volume required is 120 and over how many hours? 5. Our drop factor is 60. So you just the formula you use and you get your answer, 24 drops per minute. So you need to practice some of these things more. Then now let's have a look at some of the mental health questions, because they do come irrespective of the domain that you are writing on, whether adult nursing, mental health, learning disability, midwifery, it cuts across. Okay, but I'll advise that there are also specific past questions pertaining to midwifery, pertaining to mental health, pertaining to adult nursing that you need to study extensively in addition to these ones. So as I said, leave your email, contact me if you need them, and I will gladly share. Okay, mental health. On physical examination of a 16-year-old female patient, you will notice partial erosion of the tooth enamel and callus formation on the posterior aspect of the knuckles of the hand. This is indicative of A, self-induced vomiting, and she likely has bulimia nervosa, a generic disorder, and her sibling should be tested. C, self-mutilation and correlate with anxiety. D, a connective tissue disorder, and she should be referred to dermatology. So it's A, bulimia nervosa. They usually have this callus formation on their knuckles. It's an eating disorder. We have anorexia, nervosa, who don't eat, bulimia, excessive eating, yeah. Then another question, a patient who refuses to believe a terminal diagnosis is exhibiting A, regression, B, mourning, C, denial, D, rationalization. Then patient says, I hate this cancer. Nurse understands which stage patient is in according to Kobler-Ross stage of death. So state of mourning, stage of death, there come. So there's anger, denial, depression, bargaining, of course, anger. Then 19, this one is saying a 17-year-old patient who was involved in an orthopedic accident is observed not eating the meals that she previously ordered and refuses to take a bath even if she is already in recovery stage. As a nurse, what do you think is the best explanation for her reaction to the accident that happened to her? So A, suppression, B, undoing, C, regression, and D, repression. So of course, regression. So after the suicide of her best friend, Mary feels a sense of guilt, shame, and anger because she had not answered the phone when her friend called shortly before her death. Which of the following statements is the most accurate when talking about Mary's feelings? So A, Mary's feelings are normal and are a form of perceived loss. B, Mary's feelings are normal and are a form of situational loss. Mary's feelings are normal and are a form of situational loss. Is the this one, see this one, are not normal. So we see the difference. So we say the answer is B. Then this one says the wife of a client with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, communicates to the nurse that she's having trouble dealing with her husband's condition at home. Which of the following suggestions made by the nurse is correct? A, do not touch or speak to your husband during an active flashback. Wait until it is finished to give him support. B, discourage your husband from exercising as this was worsening his condition. C, encourage your husband to avoid regular contact with outside family members. C, keep your cupboard free of high sugar and high fat food. So we'll go through the answers, and of course the correct one is what? Do not touch or speak to your husband during an active flashback. You wait till when the person's having an attack, you don't interfere. You wait until it is done, he's calm, then you reassure him, ensure safety, and that is it, you provide support. So these are some of the questions that I'll take you through. So we'll just look at share the files, practice as much as you can, and you can make it. Thank you.
We've come to the end of yet another interesting episode. I want to thank you all for your time. Please subscribe to the channel. Please help us grow. Subscribe, like, and share with your colleagues. Sharing is caring, okay? Yeah, you lose nothing when you share information. So kindly share and subscribe to the channel for more interesting videos, okay? Those of you who have subscribed, thank you very much. Those who are here to subscribe, thank you very much. And we're doing the application. I wish you the very best of luck. Those sitting for their IELTS, I wish you the very best of luck. For the CBT, I wish you the very best of luck. May you come out with flying colors, and may we see you in the UK very soon. Bye.